Hello everyone, I am Bob and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining channel. In this build series episode, I'm going to catch you up with my build. I'm going to show you what's working and what isn't working. So with that, let's get started. Now, before I continue with this episode, I want to share some photos from a Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining build sent in by a viewer. This is a build by Gerald in Virginia. As you can see, he's got a setup where he's heating his pool using Bitcoin miner heat. Now, Gerald hired me to help consult on his build, and it's been a lot of fun seeing this to completion. So for those of you working on your own build, send me photos of what you're working on, and I'll share your build in future episodes just like this one. And if you're getting a little stuck on something, or just want a second set of eyes to look things over, my services are always available. You can send me your photos and reach me at the email address below. So with that, back to the episode. Okay, so we're here in my mining room, and as you can see, I'm not mining. And I'll get to that in a little bit. Now, I put out quite a few design episodes, and then showed you how I put that information to work in my own build. And so the focus of this episode is to go through what I got right using that information and what I got wrong. And to start off, I'm going to focus on the few things that didn't work out. And one of the first things that didn't quite work well has to do with my control system. When I went over the design of my control circuit, I noted that I was going to use 24-volt DC power. I also noted that I was going to use 24-volt definite purpose contactors to control the powers going to my miner. Now, these definite purpose contactors are made to work within HVAC systems, which normally use 24-volt AC power. Now, I thought I could make this work. I bought a relay, kind of tested it out, put the whole thing together, tested it, it worked. I showed you a video where everything was up and running, but when I got everything up and running under full power, it turns out that, yeah, using a 24-volt AC device in a 24-volt DC circuit is really not a great idea. After about 10 minutes, the DC current burnt out both of my relays. Luckily for me, I was using a Meanwell 24-volt DC power supply, which has in itself protection to handle short circuit. So other than my relays burning out, nothing else was damaged. However, I had to make a fix. Now, the right way of fixing this is to just replace the 24-volt AC relays with 24-volt DC relays. Now, in my case, since I had everything already built around my high current, high power circuitry, I really didn't want to swap out those relays. I would have had to rewire the whole entire box. So instead, what I did is I made an adjustment to my control circuit. I added in a 24-volt AC relay and 24-volt AC power supply, and so now I've got this circuit where I have a relay controlling a relay controlling a relay. Now, that's really not a great design. It's better to have everything on the same DC circuit, but given what I had, that's how I got myself back up and running, and it worked really well. I powered everything back up, and my system worked great for several days. That's a fix that I'm going to stick with here for my design. Now, once I had everything up and running, I ran into my second problem, and that has to do with my homemade dry cooler. As you remember in past episodes, I was really focused on making my dry coolers super quiet, so neither myself nor my neighbor was annoyed by these things running outside. And part of that design was to have a temperature sensor that would only turn the fan on when I needed cooling. And that was part of the problem. That temperature sensor was set a little too low, and so what is happening is that the fluid gets up to temperature, my fan kicks on, that then cools the temperature back down below the set point, the temperature switch then turns the fan back off again. So my fan is going on and off about every 10 minutes. Now, my circuit and fan are made to handle this. They can handle a ton of cycles going on and off. That's really not a problem, but that's where I get to the fan itself. If you remember, when I picked out my fan, I bought 4 or 5 different models, I turned them all on, and went for the quietest design. And to be honest, I was pretty successful there. When the fan is on and the door to my house is closed, I can't hear a thing. I talked to my neighbor, and they didn't even know the fan was running until we both went outside. At that point, you could hear the fan, and although it was very quiet, it had the same pitch and tone of a drone flying above your house, which was really kind of annoying. So although my fan is working great and the whole system is cooling down as designed, the noise is not quite what I want it to be, and I'll be fixing that in the future. And that then takes me to the final problem and the biggest problem, which is currently keeping me from mining, and that is my custom-made tank. If you noted in my tank building episode, I went out and designed my own personal plastic tank. I did this early on before I did a lot of research and learned what most tanks are made of, metal. And when I designed the tank, I focused on chemical compatibility. I wanted to make sure that the tank wouldn't decompose under the dielectric fluid. And to that point, my tank worked. Nothing melted, nothing decomposed under the chemical compatibility. But what I really missed is thermal compatibility. This type of plastic really doesn't hold well up as you start getting into the temperatures of mining. The plastic starts to get soft. Now, I did have a comment on that video, someone who's fairly bright and said, yeah, you're gonna have a problem here. And I noted, well, I'm already into the design, we'll see how it turned out, and it didn't turn out well. After the tank got up to speed and ran for about 3 days, the fitting going into my tank slowly started to deform. After a while, it deformed enough for the fluid to get past the fitting, and I had a leak. And this is where my control system kicked in and did its job. As soon as the fluid level got low enough such that my pump started to pump air through my system, my flow switch triggered. It shut down my pump, shut down my miners, and the whole system was shut down under control so nothing else was damaged. Now, when this happened, I was away at my 9-to-5 job, and this is why having a control system is a really good idea. These systems are experimental. They're one of a kind. We're all gonna be figuring things out as we go, and sometimes we're gonna make mistakes. And in this case, my control system caught that mistake and prevented further damage. Now, this is a huge setback. I spent a lot of money on this tank, and even if I were to fix this one fitting, the other fittings would fail eventually as well. So, you know, a plastic design, really not a good idea. If you look commercially out there, pretty much every tank is metal. I'm gonna have to go with a metal design, and I'll be covering that in a future episode as far as how I salvage what I have and go into a new design that's gonna work much better. Now, although these setbacks are kind of a big deal, all in all, most of the system I designed actually worked really well. First, starting off with the insulation on my tank. As I showed in a previous episode, I used some garage insulation and then some 1.5-inch foam board, and that did a great job. When my system was fully up and running and I touched the side of the insulation, it was basically at room temperature. So in my small little room here, where I really have to manage how much heat is coming off my tank, my insulation scheme worked great. Next up, looking at the piping and the pump for my miner cooling loop, again, everything worked out really well. I was a little concerned going with 3/4-inch piping. I was wondering if that would be enough, and it was plenty big. My tank never got above, say, about 100, 110 degrees. My system was running very well. I think I have tons of margin if I wanna go to overclocking in the future. And following that is my heat exchanger. Sizing heat exchanger is kind of tricky. It's really not straightforward. You have to make a few assumptions. And again, the size of heat exchanger was perfect. My system stayed under temperature, fluid flow through both cooling loops went really well. So again, that's something I got right. And that brings me to the next part of my dual loop system, which is my hydronic system. I was pretty confident with that design. There's lots of design tools out there for hydronic systems. It's a well-known technology. If you just do the math, you can kind of make sure your system's gonna work, and the system worked fantastic. My makeup system did a great job of making sure my system stayed under pressure. My expansion tank was sized correctly. My pump was sized correctly. I stayed on the lowest settings, so I've got another 2 speeds with my pump. So when I want to overclock, I've got plenty of capacity there. And so all in all, that entire half of my system was designed and worked well. And finally, the last part of my system is my homemade dry cooler. Now, as I noted when it came to the thermal switch and the fan, I've got some tweaking I need to do there, but as for the size of my dry cooler, was just fine. I think I've got plenty of capacity, I think I'll be able to handle overclocking, and I'll be able to run through the summer where temperatures here can get over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. And of course, the last part of the system I'm gonna bring up one more time is my control system. I'm really happy I spent the time and money building that because it saved me a ton when things went wrong.
Okay, so that's all I have for this episode. I've had a few setbacks, but overall things went pretty well. In future episodes, I'm gonna have to rebuild my tank and address my issues with my dry cooler, and I'm definitely gonna take you along the way. But in the next episode, I'm gonna focus on heating your house with Bitcoin. So with that, bye.